Hello, I'm David Blankenhorn, and welcome to The Conversation, sponsored by the Institute for American Values. Very happy to have at the table with me tonight Lawrence Mead, who is a professor of politics at New York University, who is a signatory to our statement, a call to a new conversation on marriage, and who's a longtime friend. And I'm really delighted to have you.
Well, I'm delighted to be here.
We have a lot to talk about. We're going to talk about marriage and inequality. We're going to talk about the relationship between trends in marriage and trends in social inequality. I want to talk a little bit about marriage and the poor. I want to talk with you a little bit about marriage in the middle class. And I want to talk a little bit at the end about the gay marriage issue and how that relates to it. So that's kind of the arc of the conversation. But let's rewind the tape for a moment. Talk about you. Grew up in Huntington, Long Island.
That's right.
Where you learned to sail. You went to Amherst College. You went to Harvard and got a PhD in government there. You studied, I think, with the great Samuel Beer.
That's right. And other great teachers.
I think of him as kind of the iconic mid-century analyst of British and American political institutions. I was lucky enough to take a course with him there. And after doing a few interesting things in and around the policy world, you have been at NYU since 1979, where you are a prominent public intellectual and professor of politics. And as a segue to getting into talking about marriage and the poor, I want to say that I have admired you personally, and I've admired your work for a long time, and I want to tell you why. There are very few people of whom it can be said that through sheer intellectual firepower and the kind of passion and precision of a public argument that a country changed its mind on something. And that can be said about you. You had an idea. I'm not saying you did it all yourself, but I think as much as anybody in the country, you changed the way we think about a set of topics. The way, I want you to say this in your own words, the way I think about it, you had an idea in the early 1980s about poverty and what might be called the obligations of citizenship. Say what that idea is.
I think the core idea was that the poor suffered from a lack of obligations as much or more than from a lack of opportunity. The usual view is that poor people need expanded chances to get ahead, to improve themselves. And that's often true. I think that can be true. But the other thing that they need is to fulfill the responsibilities that other Americans expect of each other in order to become regular members of the society. And you have to, in order to do that, you have to satisfy a set of competences, responsibilities that I call the common obligations, such as working for a living, obeying a law, getting through school, speaking English. Those things are also necessary to citizenship. So we have to get away from the idea that citizenship consists only of rights and claims. It also involves responsibilities, and these things have to go together. So my view about poverty was that the poor had more rights than they had obligations. And so it was necessary to reaffirm the common obligations in connection with poverty. That meant especially that we had to require work of people who were able to work and who were also dependent on the government. Now, my view differed from other conservatives in that I wasn't against welfare as such. I wasn't saying we should abolish the welfare state. But that state should become, to some extent, conditional on fulfilling the common obligations.
I remember you saying it wasn't that you thought the welfare state was doing too little or too much, but it was doing the wrong, it was doing it the wrong way. It was doing it too permissively, without enough authority.
That's right. So the problem isn't that the welfare state is too big, but that it's too permissive, that it involves entitlement, where people get support simply by being poor, and regardless of whether they can help themselves. So my view is actually quite close to that of public opinion. The average American also wants to help the poor, but expects the poor to help themselves. And those things are often seen as opposites in Washington. If you help the poor, then you're not expecting them to help themselves, and vice versa. If you expect them to help themselves, then they're not getting aid from government. It seems to me those things ought to go together.
And one's called liberal and one's called conservative.
Yeah, so I'm a big government conservative. I want there to be help for the poor, but I also want that help.
You don't want laissez-faire.
That's right.
Law of the jungle, people make it on their own and the devil take the hind part. Nor do you want a kind of handout regime.
That's right. Correct. So we want to help the poor, but they should also help themselves. And that combination is much more effective in helping them than doing either thing alone. So, and the other thing that I did was to try to, I learned a fair amount through research about what it takes to put people to work and how does one actually do that operationally. I did a number of studies about how to do that. And that research also helped to shape the policies in the 90s. So we now have a regime where if you're on welfare, you're expected to work. And that means that you get help, but you also have to contribute by earning your own money. And the two together are designed to get you out of poverty.
Now, your book, Beyond Entitlement, I think that was, don't you think that was kind of a, to me, it was kind of a breakthrough book. It had a big influence on public opinion. That came out in 1986.
That's right.
And then you spent a lot of time testifying before legislative committees.
Yeah.
Speaking publicly on the issue, doing further academic research,
correct,
being involved in the academic debate on this.
Yes.
And when did, because in the early 1980s, the idea that you just expressed was an outlier idea.
Yes.
That was not a popular idea.
Yeah. Well, it was with the public. The public were always in favor of this.
Yes.
But our policy didn't express it.
Right.
And among experts, the dominant way of understanding poverty was in terms of barriers to opportunity.
Right.
Most of the experts were then and still are economists and sociologists who were focused on social forces surrounding the poor.
Lifting away removing obstacles.
That's right. That's right.
Was going to
liberate people to move forward. Now, so the left said, and most of these people were liberals, the left said we need to use government to push back barriers to opportunity. And the right said government itself is a barrier to opportunity, so we must cut back government. And my view is different from both of them. I said your problem is you're trying to use freedom to solve a problem that's basically a problem of order. Poverty, I see, is basically due to a breakdown of order, where people no longer function in ways that are accepted. And by restoring order, we can also overcome poverty. So that implies that the poor don't so much need more opportunities, they need, in some ways, they need fewer choices rather than more. You need to say to them, you have to work. This is an obligation.
Didn't you have a book or a book chapter or something called The New Paternalism?
I had a book called that. That was an edited volume that came out after Beyond Entitlement and The New Politics of Poverty. That applied this basic idea in welfare, but also in other areas of social policy. And it has actually progressed. It's now an approach that you see in a number of other areas besides welfare.
So the public policy needs to have an element of paternalism.
Yes.
That is orienting and guiding and in some cases requiring certain behavior as a condition of receiving the benefits of public welfare.
Correct. See, the dominant view is we must offer people choices. In my sense is we should offer people direction.
I try to tell my children this, they don't believe me.
It has similarities to what goes on in a family.
Yeah,
I admit that.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, when did the public? Okay, you said the public has always more or less thought this.
That's right.
When did the political pendulum adopt, broadly speaking, in the U.S. and now increasingly in Britain and other countries?
Mm-hmm.
When did it turn toward embracing this as a philosophy?
The first important turning occurs in the late 80s at the time of a federal enactment called the Family Support Act.
Right.
This was the welfare reform bill prior to the radical reform of the 90s. This bill took the first important steps towards requiring work as a condition of receiving family aid. The main focus was on a family aid program called Aid to Families with Dependent Children. And in this enactment, you see the first attempts to build up work requirements. They already existed, but they weren't really serious. Now they became more serious. And that act by itself wasn't very successful. And in the early 90s, there was a further increase in the welfare rolls, and there was continuing public pressure about the issue. And then you get the more radical reform of the 90s.
1996.
Yeah, correct.
The under President
correct.
Clinton.
Yes.
This was, in some ways, the turning point.
That was the really radical turning point, but let's remember that that enactment was mostly the doing of Republicans. That is, Clinton signed the bill and implemented it well, so he gets a lot of credit. But the bill was drafted by the Republicans, particularly in the House. They were much more militant about enforcing work than the Democrats were, and they insisted on it. And so we now have a system that is really quite insistent about having welfare mothers work. Now, there are still certain limits to those requirements, and there are further things we can do to improve them. But I would say the turning point came in the late 80s through the middle 90s.
Yeah. Now, I'm going to read a quote from I think your most recent book, called From Prophecy to Charity, How to Help the Poor. Quote, poverty tends to arise in the first place because poor parents have children outside of marriage and then do not work regularly to support them.
Correct.
A couple of sentences later, we see this paragraph. Poverty would be a simple problem if it only meant economic need. Sometimes it does. Children, the elderly and disabled, and families in the grips of natural disasters, all can be made destitute by forces beyond their control. But in an affluent society like ours, poverty is not usually forced on people for very long by conditions. Typically, it has a behavioral dimension as well. The poor may suffer from low wages or health problems, for example, but most have become poor, at least in part, due to not working, having children outside of marriage, abusing drugs, or breaking the law. This is particularly true for people who remain poor for more than a year or two.
That's right.
So, when people say to you, that is mean language because
yeah.
you are ignoring the larger social forces and trends, mm-hmm. such as the loss of middle-income jobs, the mm-hmm. flee, the movement of jobs out of the cities where poor people yeah. live, the deteriorating educational conditions facing mm-hmm. many people, and other large social trends, you are ignoring these mm-hmm. in favor of focusing on internal questions of the behavior
yeah.
of the people involved.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do you respond to that in general?
I agree in part. When we talk about how poverty arises, the focus should be on lifestyle. That is indeed the most important thing. But once the poor are working, then they encounter all of the limitations and opportunity that you mentioned. I don't think that those are a myth at all. I think inequality is a real problem. Low wages is a real problem. There are many limitations about American society that we should address.
Racism,
yeah,
the whole
all of that.
Gamut of social
correct.
Conditions.
But those things become relevant after one is functioning and fulfilling the common obligations. It's actually workers and not the non-workers who suffer the most from the economy. It's after you're working.
You have to be in the system.
Yeah.
To be
yes.
harmed by the deficiencies of the system
exactly.
as it operates.
And the way I put it is, it's by going to work that you become unequal. And it's only by doing that that it's meaningful to talk about inequality. Inequality is really not a meaningful idea except when you're talking about people in the labor force. They are functioning, they have moral claims because they're functioning. And inequality is much more significant for them than it is for people who are outside the economy, which is typically the poor. So my view, actually, is that were we to require work seriously of the poor, and that includes not just welfare mothers but others, if we did that, the effect would actually be to shift politics to the left, because those people would have moral claims that they don't now have when they're outside the economy. They would be able to make the sort of claims on the government that workers made in the 30s. When there clearly were no jobs and where the economy was a lot more hostile than it is today. You could have a left-wing movement today on behalf of workers who were distressed. And I think that's part of what happened in the Obama administration. Precisely by reforming welfare in the 90s, we shifted that issue off the front burner and brought the problems of poor, struggling families onto the front burner. That's exactly what I thought was going to happen. And that's very much of the credit of welfare reform.
In the system, yeah. Making claims on the system.
Yes. You have to be a worker. You have
now,
to be a worker.
You say you have to be a worker.
Yeah.
And I want to push a little bit or explore a little bit with you on the marriage question.
Yeah.
If sitting here as the third person at this table were a, say, a 17 or 18 or 19-year-old young woman,
yeah.
with not more than a high school degree, maybe mm-hmm. not even that,
yeah.
with one child and no job, and
yeah.
needing or feeling the need to apply to the public for assistance.
Yeah.
Is it a fair criticism to say that Larry Mead looks at her and sees someone who's not working? Because when I look at a person like that and
yeah.
have looked at a person like that,
yeah.
I see a person who's had a child mm-hmm. outside of marriage, and that's the most important
yeah.
fact about
yeah.
her.
Yes.
Not the fact that she's unemployed.
Mm-hmm.
And your work requirements and your the yeah. what you're, you know, in other words, is she an unemployed worker or is she an unmarried
yeah, yeah.
mother?
Well, both things are true, but we have focused on the work problem primarily because that's what we can do something about.
The government,
society.
Make requirements
yes,
about work.
We can do something about work. We've had a harder time doing something about marriage. They're about equally important in causing poverty, actually. And
when you say equal, do you mean literally statistically
yeah.
50%?
That about the if I had to say which of the two was the most important for making people poor, lack of work is a little more important, but not a lot. If the fact that you're a single mother without a husband is also very important, that is also a major cause of poverty. But the reason I haven't focused on that is because that is not as popular and is something not as easy for government to do as requiring work.
My friend Barbara
yeah.
Whitehead says that during the 80s and the 90s, we as a society spent a lot of time perfecting the concept of the working mother.
Yes.
That in all classes
yes.
of society, the idea of mothers should be working.
Yes.
And so that when it came to poor young
uh-huh.
poor mothers, well, what did we think about that? Send them to work.
Yeah.
You know,
and you might
don't
say,
you think there's a legitimate critique there?
At the outset, yes. But as it turned out, having the mother go to work was actually pro-marriage. That actually supported marriage. And it was the only thing we found that actually does support marriage that we can do through policy.
Well, how does it support?
Well, we have evidence.
How does a work requirement
in
welfare,
correct,
usually accompanied by things like child care supports and so
yep,
forth,
yep.
how does that encourage marriage?
Well, what we know is that a mother who is required to work is more likely to marry than one who isn't. And
because
also,
she's participating in the flow of things.
It's mainly because she has more income than she would have just on welfare. And when low-income adults have more income, they think they can afford to get married. Now, this attitude is a little bit crazy. We'll need to talk about it. But that's their attitude. If I'm more comfortable economically, then I can afford to get married. Whereas actually the truth is the opposite. If they married, they would less likely be poor in the first place. But that's their attitude. And we also have found that for the mother work is positive for the children. That was unexpected. Many people thought the children would be harmed. And so actually it's pro-family.
Mother going to work as a condition of receiving benefits
yeah.
creates better outcomes for the children than
yes.
if she were not working.
To be more precise, if she was not required to work.
If she was not required to work.
Yes.
And why do you think that is?
Well, it's either due because the mother, it might be because the mother, when she's working, feels better about herself and is more confident and more effective as a caregiver. And the other reason is that the child goes into child care, which is often better for the child than sitting at home with a mother. Actually, child care is better for children than living at home with a single mother who isn't working, on average. And so these are reasons why the children actually benefit from the mother going to work. This is quite contrary to what many people expected. Now, these effects are not large, and I shouldn't emphasize them. The mother's, the main gain for the mother is simply higher income. And that does have a pro-marriage effect. And there are also many anecdotes about how when the mother goes to work, the father, who often is outside the family, actually returns and helps the mother take care of the children. So the father often becomes the child care person.
You're saying that studies suggest there can be a ripple effect,
yes.
A positive upward spiral.
That's right.
That is centered in the requirement to work as
That's
a condition
right.
of public assistance.
That's right. That appears to have...
Even if
yeah.
young mother, mm-hmm. poorly educated, everything else, make a work requirement,
yeah.
and things get better for her because she has more money,
That's right.
and because other positive
yeah.
human capital building
Correct.
Cycles get
Correct.
Triggered.
That's
so you're
right.
not going to back down off
no,
of this.
No, I'm not. But at the same time, I don't contend that these effects are large, and they certainly don't get to the core of the marriage problem. And I have to say right now, we haven't been able to develop effective policies against the decline in marriage for two basic reasons. One of them is that it's not nearly as popular as putting people to work. The public is really squirrely about requiring...
The public is ambivalent
yeah.
about this
yes.
in a way that we... are not ambivalent
That's
about
right.
work,
That's
work,
right.
work.
That's right. Work we feel good about, we think we can do it, and we're prepared to enforce it. But we're not prepared to do any of those things in connection with marriage. The public is a lot less confident about marriage. They think it's more difficult.
And
they seem more troublesome.
See it as a purely private choice.
And they don't want to stigmatize single mothers.
They don't want to stigmatize... Yeah. The unmarried moms.
Correct. They're prepared to stigmatize the non-worker, but not a single mother, even though it's the same person. So they'll say to the single mother, you have to work, and if you don't, you're in some way at fault, but we ignore the fact that you're a single mother. That's the attitude right now. And also, programs to promote marriage that the government has been evaluating have not evaluated well. We have some programs designed to counsel...
You're speaking now of the programs that were funded under Bush 43.
Yeah, correct.
I was involved in those.
Correct.
And they have been fairly carefully evaluated, and the
yes.
results so far have been, I would say, mixed, leaning toward not encouraging.
Yes, yes. And I'm not surprised by that because these programs are voluntary. They don't involve any clear direction. They don't say to people, you should be married or you should... in other words, any way to change your lifestyle, and the results have been disappointing. So I don't think we have right now an obvious answer to the marriage problem among low-income people, except simply to restore stigma. To say,
and the only know, way we, the only handle for public policy with respect to fathers is child support,
yes.
which becomes its own separate regime
yeah.
with its own separate logic.
Correct.
It almost becomes a parallel system to what
it
otherwise
is.
Would be a marriage system.
It is. In fact, I actually wrote a book, my last book but one, about how to put the fathers to work using child support. And when you do that, that also has pro-marriage effects. There's evidence that if you require the father to pay child support, he's more likely to have contact with the child. So child support is constructive for the family, just like work requirements for the mother. Again, effects are not large, but they are positive. So child support is one of the things we need to improve in order to deal with the marriage question. But it doesn't cut to the core of the issue. I agree with that.
Now, I want to show you a poster. And Andy, if you can show it on the screen.
Yeah.
It's this poster. You've probably seen it. They're on the New York City
yeah.
subways
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I've been watching this.
You've been seeing
yeah.
these? This is the one I'm interested in now. It's for it's a part of a campaign by the
yeah,
Bloomberg administration to discourage teen pregnancy.
Yeah.
And you have some unhappy-looking children here
yeah.
on the side.
Yeah.
And then the line says, if you finish high school, get a job, and get married before having children, you have a 98% chance of not being in poverty.
Yeah, correct.
I think this is the first publicly funded
yeah.
advertisement I've ever seen
yeah, I
that
know.
Says something about marriage.
See, and this is what I think the major answer to the decline of marriage among poor people anyway is going to have to be this sort of thing, where what we do is withdraw some of the tolerance that we've had for single parenthood in the last 20, 30 years. we have to say this turned out to be a bad idea.
We put this up on our blog, and people ripped into it.
Yeah.
People ripped into it.
I'm not surprised.
They said this was a shaming technique.
Yeah.
That these young women were more victims than somebody that needs to have their finger pointed at them.
Yeah.
They, and publicly, these ads have been strongly criticized by many community leaders. How dare you say this?
Yeah.
You're not having sympathy for that complaint.
Correct.
Because why? Because, A, it is true. The statement is true.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that's
what
Sawhill,
Haskins, this is the success
the
sequence.
The sequence of success. If you graduate from high school,
that's right.
Get a job and keep working, and don't have children until you're married, the chances of the child and you being in poverty shrink to a very, very small number.
That's true.
Whereas
that's exactly
if you don't
right.
do any of those things, you're in the, 80% likelihood of being poor.
That's true. That's exactly right. What's interesting is the backlash. You see, the public is saying, or those who reacted anyway, they're saying, this is precisely what we can't do. We can't stigmatize people. But I don't see an alternative to that. We have to say, we're not stigmatizing the individual. We're saying, this behavior, this lifestyle is undesirable. We used to say that as a society back in the 50s and the 60s. And after that, we get this escalation of unwed pregnancy. And I think at first our instinct to be tolerant and understanding was laudable. I don't think we understood what the effects were at that point. But research makes it very clear. Not only are you more likely to be poor, but outcomes for the children are worse. The children raised in a single-parent family are going to do worse at school and worse later in life than those who are raised with two parents. And that's true controlling for many other factors that might be involved. So
you want society, through public policy, to be much more authoritative about communicating the norm.
Yes. We have to do it. We have to go back to a regime where we disapprove of unwed pregnancy. I think that's clear. Now, at the same time, I think we should understand the struggle that involves. We don't have to be unsympathetic. We can understand how difficult this often is. I'm not saying that a single mother is, that her life is over, that she's outside society. No, I'm not saying that.
Even there's some terrible line between us and her.
Yeah.
This, that we're talking about our society and what we uphold. I mean, it's not that angry finger pointing usually doesn't have a good effect. But if you can communicate clearly, that here's what we're aiming at.
Yes. Well, see, in other areas we do this. If you look at schools or careers, society manages to be both demanding and sympathetic at the same time. We say you have to meet certain standards to get through school or to graduate from college. And those are demanding standards. And we understand if you have a struggle, and we help you out in various ways. We have public programs. And if you fail, you can try again. But you still have to get over the hurdle. We don't lower the standard.
It's interesting, or Moynihan famously called it defining deviancy down.
Yeah,
right?
Correct.
Yeah. Now, it's interesting because in your book, From Prophecy to Charity, you use the word charity.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're using it in the Christian sense of love.
Correct.
I was, I'm a thrift. I love the concept of history of the word thrift.
Yeah.
And whether you know it or not, man, I've never known anybody who is more in keeping with this whole philosophy, man. You're it. You are it, man.
I realize
you're
that.
You and I may be the two of the last two guys left, they hated the word charity.
I know.
They denounced it from high heaven for your reasons.
Yeah, correct.
I mean, my shelf up there is filled with books like this. Giving people things, handing them stuff. They hated that idea. Nor did they think you should do nothing to help people.
Correct.
What they wanted to do, and they would say this over and over again, it is what they would have said, it is our obligation to help people who are prepared to help themselves.
Yes, exactly.
That is the truism of that point of view.
Well, the reason
and they thought of charity as a kind of a morally callous sense of just handing out things to people.
The reason I wrote From Privacy to Charity, and I wrote another book before that, co-authored with Mary Jo Bain, the reason I wrote those two books was to address this theological question. What does it mean in the Bible to help the needy? Now, the dominant view, which is a characteristic of seminaries and virtually all denominations that I know, including the Catholic Church and Protestant as well, is that helping the poor means to give them what they need with no questions asked. And you should not demand good behavior.
Give them what they need by way of material things.
Yeah. Yeah, the idea is to help people without questions. And that's what's characteristic of the Bible, particularly of the New Testament. That's what Jesus is thought to do in various stories in the New Testament. Now, as I read it, if that's true, then it's hard to justify these policies of reciprocity, of obligation, of enforcement that I'm talking about. But as I read
Christian, you wanted to go back and rethink this.
Yes.
Exactly. You wanted to re-examine Jesus' mission.
Precisely.
And what were the results of your researches?
Well, what I see is a Jesus who is more directive than is commonly understood, who is prepared to expect people to participate in their own salvation. He's not a magician who saves people in spite of themselves. He doesn't enact or call for acts of social justice. He helps people in trouble, but he also expects them to do various things to help themselves. He also does not suspend the normal expectations about good behavior. He doesn't say you don't have to do this, that, and the other as required by the Jewish law.
Or if you're in a certain category of people where these rules don't apply to you.
Correct.
Right.
He says essentially that yes, there is forgiveness. 70 times 7, he's forgiving, but the rules are still the rules, and you're still expected to behave well. Whereas what the liberal church mostly does is exempt the poor from any expectation. They basically say because you're disadvantaged, because you've faced various problems, because society is unjust, you shouldn't have to function. The laws don't apply to you. Indeed, the laws are a bad thing. They actually get in the way of helping, of being loving.
So what I notice too is that a lot of times the people who have that point of view would never think that way about their own lives or the lives of their children.
Correct. Yes. That's right.
You know, in other words, when it comes to me and mine, I'm absolutely for the work ethic. I believe in the connection between effort and reward. I believe in deferred gratification. Yeah. I believe in building up human capital. But when it comes to these other people out there, why, my goodness.
Yeah.
I would never.
Correct.
No, there is something.
So, see, what the elite tends to do, they understand their lives. They may say they have many opportunities, and they do, and there's no question about that. They're very fortunate. But the actual conduct of their life is all about obligations. They and their children both spend their lives fulfilling the expectations that they have assumed. These are what I call in more recent work the burdens of freedom. They absorb the burdens of freedom. And that's what life is about, mostly, is fulfilling these expectations. It's really not about freedom in the sense that people talk about poverty. People say the poor need more freedom, more opportunity, but life is really about obligation.
And I tell you, you're a thrift guy, man. you're the old-fashioned Protestant thing.
Correct.
You know, that's it.
I know.
And
if there's anything that amazes me about this whole turning of the debate, is that as an old-fashioned Protestant Puritan, going back to the Mayflower and so on, I never thought my way of thinking would ever have any influence on public policy. But as these
couldn't have picked a more inauspicious time to have begun preaching this.
I know, but because we have these problems, we have to do what solutions require, and they do require enforcing good behavior. I don't see any alternative. But again, to say that doesn't mean we don't help. We also provide help, and therefore I'm not anti-government. I'm not saying we shouldn't be giving people benefits. In fact, I advocate various additional benefits.
Your way of thinking in some ways requires more government.
Yes, it does.
More taxpayer money out of my and your pocket.
Exactly.
To pay for programs to help those who have been left behind.
That's right.
But to do it in a way that can sound a little either shocking or bracing, depending on how you look at
That's right.
To those who have a view of charity that is not the view that you're putting forward.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. If you think helping the poor primarily involves lifting burdens off them, then you're in a different world from mine. That is not the problem as I see it. I think it's rather a problem of combining support with obligations such that people experience the same sorts of responsibilities that are faced by people not on welfare.
Do you think liberalism, in the recent couple of conversations around this table, we've talked a little bit about the role of liberals possibly in renewing marriage and the role of conservatives.
Yeah.
Do you think there's been a change? Is your argument now more, I think it's certainly more mainstream in almost every possible way.
Yeah.
Do you think it's, is, do you think that, say, left of center people in the worlds of public policy analysis tend to be more accepting of it now than they were, say, 20 years ago?
I think it's there's more acceptance among academics who study this problem. They see the need for good behavior. They may not advocate it themselves, but they acquiesce. They see the need for it. And I don't see a whole lot of opposition to the work requirements that we instituted in the 90s. That, those are now pretty well accepted.
Bipartisan.
Yeah, I think that's right. Among politicians, though, it's clearer than among the experts. The thing that prevents the experts, most experts, from endorsing the kind of analysis that I'm advocating is partly because they continue to see poverty in terms of social barriers. And my view requires seeing poverty in terms of lack of obligations, which is almost the opposite. And the other big difference is most of the other experts are economists or sociologists who don't really think in terms of institutions, whereas the policies I'm recommending are highly institutional. They require that there be administration, that there be programs that put people to work or keep you in school or do other things to promote a positive lifestyle. That requires direction. You have to have staff who are oversee the clients and help them, but also expect them to do the right thing.
I mean, one of the things I've learned from you and admired from you over the years is that you are not an academic in the sense of just in the library.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
There is a serious intellectual product and scholarly product that you have built up, but you also get out there in America and get a little dirt on your shoes talking to people.
Correct.
Visiting with policymakers, seeing how these programs actually work in practice.
Yes.
And no substitute for that.
Yeah, correct.
No
substitute. In fact, most of the perceptions that I've had about how to address this problem have come in the field from talking to people now and already involved in these welfare work programs or comparable programs for men. They told me the essential things that I'm now saying. Now, I backed it up with more structured kinds of research, including various statistical studies and so on, but the fundamental perceptions came from people I heard about in the field.
Let's switch now and talk about the middle class. I think we would agree that there is a dramatic and growing split in our country between, I guess we could quarrel about percentages, but let's just say the top 30% of the country, college, four-year college degrees, let's call them upscale America.
Yeah, that's a good name.
They are, they're not rich, but they have a four-year college degree, they're working, they're overwhelmed, they're marrying and leading more or less conventional, competent lives.
Correct.
And by most measures, thriving.
Yes.
Leaving aside the very poor people that we've been talking about, let's think about this sort of middle 50 or 60%. Here you see more and more separation between them and the upscale.
Yes.
There's a, there's this some kind of almost a two-nation quality emerging here between 30% upscale in the rest of America.
Correct.
On every indicator that you can say, whether it's money or everywhere.
Yeah, correct.
What in your view is causing this?
Yeah. Well, let's first of all define what the division is about. It is, in fact, mostly about marriage. If you look what separates the upper 30% from the middle, the biggest single difference is that marriage is declining.
Can I read you a couple of quick statistics? I know you know these. Children born outside of marriage. Among highly educated mothers, this is in 2011. Mm-hmm. Highly educated means a four-year college degree.
Right.
Children born outside of marriage among highly educated, 6%.
Yeah.
Among moderately educated, that's high school, 44%.
That was a huge
among poorly educated, 54%.
Yeah.
One more statistic. And this talks about a trend line.
Mm-hmm.
The chances of a teenage girl living in an intact family, between the chances, the change in the chances between the 1970s and today.
Yeah.
Among highly educated households, no change.
Yeah. Yes.
Among moderately educated households, 16% drop in the likelihood of living in an intact home.
Yeah.
Among poorly educated, 13% drop.
Yeah.
So, not only is the gap itself significant, but in terms of family structure, the divide, it's really going like that.
Yeah.
You know, like that.
I know.
So, but would you say that the family structure trend is the most important driver of it?
Yes. I think, see, amongst the middle class, the employment problems we were talking about are much less obvious.
People are working.
Yeah.
They may have crummy jobs.
Yeah, correct.
They may be working seasonally.
Correct. And now there is some lack of regular work sometimes, but you don't, what you don't see is the long-term separation of the labor force that is often true amongst the poor population. You don't see that here. So employment is not the main problem. But private life is the main problem. It has to do with maintaining marriage, either getting married or staying married. And the reasons for that, I think, have to lie mostly with culture. Now, there are a number of economic theories that has to do with greater insecurity, with the disappearance.
It's the same set of theories that you didn't like when you were thinking about the poor.
That's right.
It has to do with outside forces.
That's right.
The good-paying jobs are going overseas.
That's right.
Technological the educational requirements now are such that everybody but the super educated can't quite get access to a good paying job.
Correct.
There are these macro trends in the economy, mostly the global economy, that are alleged to be the drivers here. You're not buying.
I don't believe that. Jobs are still available. We are still experiencing massive immigration from the underdeveloped world. It's currently more legal than illegal, but for a long time it was heavily illegal. That's an issue in Congress right now. These immigrants are coming here because jobs are available. They're certainly not good jobs, but if you claim remaining benefits like food stamps and your income tax credit, you will not be poor if you work at any legal job in America. You can avoid poverty. Jobs are available. Therefore, we can't really blame the marriage problem on the economy. And attempts to do that, I think, are futile and unconvincing. Let's remember how tough the economy was back in the 30s, 40s, 50s, when things were a lot less rich than now. Wage levels were much lower. We had unexpected recessions. We had the huge depression in the 30s, which was worse than anything we've seen, even the recent recession here. But marriage rates were high. Marriage was not in crisis back then, and conditions were actually more severe than now by quite a bit. So we really
some statistics suggest even a lessening of family breakup because of this sense of you closed ranks with a sense of family solidarity.
Correct.
That became your last ditch effort to maintain some kind of communal safety
now,
net.
Some people who study that era closely say that extreme hardship did finally put pressure on marriage and there were marriage problems, but nothing like what we're seeing today. So I don't think you can blame the marriage problem on the economy.
But you think this, you think that upscale, now here's another candidate.
Yeah.
Access to a four-year college degree. In other words, the other thing that separates educational attainment can be a fairly accurate proxy for this divide we're seeing.
I think it is.
So you could say that instead of pointing fingers about family structure, just send everybody to college.
Well, we've tried to do that, and we found out that we can't. The standards that are required to get through college are too much for many people. It's not surprising. It didn't used to be required to go to college to be married. It was enough to be a high school graduate, indeed not even a high school graduate. I don't think that that's plausible. I think much more plausible is that people who are themselves college educated imagine this for their own children. And one of the major changes in America in the last 20, 30 years has been a tightening of what I call the meritocratic scramble, the struggle to get into a good college. That has become much more intense than it was 20, 30 years.
Oh, my goodness.
And
it's nothing compared to what it was when we were doing this. It was a cakewalk for us compared to what
The outcome would have been very, very much different for us if we'd faced the same level of competition, but certainly we're less anxious about it. There's about that. And one of the things
I hardly knew it was happening. Followed the crowd at chow time,
One of the reasons why marriage is stronger amongst the elite is because they are thinking of their own children going to college, and they know that these children need their support right through high school if they're going to be competitive. So that's one thing that helps to maintain marriage amongst the well-educated. They're trying to see their kids repeat what they went through, and therefore they're less likely to break up because the parents know that that's hard on the child, and the child is
far,
the most competitive.
Far more likely to get married before having the child.
Correct.
They still maintain more or less the traditional sequence of love, marriage, baby carriage.
That's right.
But what, when I first got involved in public debate on this issue among conservatives, remember this idea that it was the upper educated people that were the big screw-ups in life?
Yeah, exactly.
They were supposed to, these deracinated liberals,
correct.
These lifestyle latte-drinking liberals, but the real Americans out there, it's the opposite.
It's turned out the opposite.
Now, these college-educated, breed, white wine-sipping people are the ones who are the most conventional.
What you just quoted is what I call the Hollywood theory of poverty. The idea that the elite is liberated about marriage and other conventional moralities, and they can afford it because they have affluence and they can just get away with it. Whereas poor people can't. So if they try to be liberated about marriage, they get in trouble. Whereas people from Hollywood don't get in trouble. But you're absolutely right, except for Hollywood maybe. The upper middle class has become very, very orthodox about marriage.
They work like crazy, defer gratification, no conspicuous consumption.
That's right.
It's the shoulder to the wheel.
Right. That's exactly right. also, the prestige of higher education and the whole education system has increased enormously in the last 20 years. People who are prominent in that system are now mentors to the society in a way that they weren't back in the 60s. And the upshot is that everything surrounding the meritocracy has immense authority. And that, I think, is one of the reasons why marriage has firmed up amongst the elite. One of the reasons why it may be collapsing in the middle of society is because those people think they're not competitive and they can't get their kids into college and there's no reason why they should try. So they live for the moment, and there's this puzzling lack of commitment to any long-term goals.
It just seems to me, and one of the reasons why we wanted to have this new focus, new what we're calling the new conversation on marriage, is because of this. I mean, I'm reluctant to engage in apocalyptic rhetoric, but it just seems to me that if you wanted to identify the single biggest threat social threat to the maintenance of a broad middle-class American society,
I think you're right.
You would pick, arguably pick, the absolute disintegration of family structure among 50 or 60% of our, what used to be the kind of broad blue-collar, lower-middle-class America, with the, you know, with the broad shoulders, that this was America. You know, yes, we had some rich people, yes, we had some poor people, but we had this, a kind of middle-class society where most people thought of themselves in this way, and they were participating broadly in the marriage institution.
See, what's distressing is that we seem...
This is what's
We haven't found a way to counter this, whereas we have countered some other evils that threaten the country. And I'm thinking of the work issue again, which you already talked about. Also, crime. Crime is vastly down from what it was in the 70s and 80s. We've restored order in some aspects in American society.
What about drugs, no?
Drugs, there, I'm not sure about the immediate facts, but the problem is certainly not getting any worse. It's an economic issue as much as anything. It's a form of illicit income that sustains an entire industry. And it's clearly an issue. I don't mean we've totally solved it. But I don't believe that it's tearing the country apart.
But if you look at the issues of work, if you look at the issue of crime, law and order, and if you look at the issue of family structure, marriage, and the living conditions of children that arise from family structure, I think it would be justified in arguing that the weakening of the family structure is this single biggest engine
I agree with
of
that.
The growth of inequality. Think that's true?
I do.
Justified by evidence?
There are a number of sources to the growing inequality. Some of them have to do with Wall Street. They have to do with the tax system.
Right.
I'm not saying that's unimportant. But we don't talk enough about the social problems, which are also a contributor. In particular...
And the global trends, the international trends in the economy, of course.
Yes, but the
relocation of factory jobs overseas. Yep.
As a matter of fact, some of those jobs are coming home now. I mean, it looks as if the great offshoring movement is over. It's some of those jobs are returning. So America's,
some money getting sucked out of the economy by these people on Wall Street who gamble with it to no productive purpose.
Yes, and the tax system somehow allows them to get away with murder, so it appears.
Yes.
I'm not minimizing that, but the thing people don't talk about is one of the reasons for growing inequality is the decline of earnings at the bottom of society, which causes them to be less equal. In fact, in the 90s, due to welfare reform, where we put so many welfare mothers to work, the inequality actually reversed for a little while. For several years in the late 90s, inequality went backwards. It actually fell because so many more people were working at the bottom. And that actually...
They were receiving earnings from work plus various kinds of assistance, child care, wage supplements, and so forth.
Yeah.
That they qualified for by virtue of being Larry Mead type participants in the system.
Now, some of those benefits they would have got without work, but others were dependent on work, absolutely.
Right.
So the effect was less inequality. And more importantly than the economics of this is the political side of it. If people are functioning and working, their claims in politics are a lot stronger than otherwise. And as I said before, I think one reason why the Obama administration has been more liberal in terms of social policy than was true under preceding administrations, is precisely due to the success of welfare reform. The fact we put so many people to work had the effect of strengthening their claims.
Yes.
That's why you get Obamacare, why you get expansion to Social Security.
Yes.
Those things were justified by the need to help struggling working families.
I noticed, too, at his State of the Union, I was very pleased when he said we need to end the marriage penalties in our welfare and tax systems for low-income Americans.
Yeah,
and I think that's another example of what you're talking about. That is, addressing a justice and social policy issue on the part of low-income people who have a claim.
Yeah, correct.
They have a claim.
Correct. And
yes.
I'm very much in favor of low-income people having a claim. But to have the claim, they have to fulfill the common obligations. Now, I think in some ways what's troublesome about the marriage problem, it is certainly very serious, but we haven't found a way yet to tackle it through government the way we did the other problems, the work issue, the crime issue, and so on.
Now that we're talking about the middle class, the disintegration of marriage in the broad middle of the society, this does not automatically put most or even very many people at all on public assistance.
No, correct.
It just puts them in a diminished life chances for themselves and their children.
That's
it makes life more punishing, chaotic. There's more suffering.
Yeah, correct.
Outcome, the prospects for their children become, as you say, nobody is doomed by this, but it's not. We have some researchers, David and Amber Lapp, out in Ohio as we speak, working in a white, blue-collar town, looking at marriage and children's issues, and it's a a distressing portrait of the kind of deinstitutionalization.
Yeah. See, what I found distressing about their work, and I read one of these reports, and it's very graphic, is the decline of capacity to commit. See, what happened previously in the middle class, people saw life as a project where you set out to achieve certain goals. And those jobs are partly in terms of career. You want to achieve certain career goals. Also, you want to bring your children up and have them be your successors. And you have other goals for your community, perhaps, and organizations you're involved in. And you work towards them over time. Now, what's disturbing about the lab findings, seems to me, and this is other research shows this also, is the episodic quality of commitments today. People drift in and out of commitments. They say, I'm going to do such a thing, but then they don't really do it. And that goes for marriage, it also goes for work, it also goes for other commitments. What you don't see is the capacity to maintain a commitment over time. That's what seems to be declining. And it's a broader problem just than marriage. It has to do with all kinds of goals that people might have. And the loss of that directedness, the capacity to pursue a goal, that I think is what really threatens the dynamism of America.
Now, you're talking about things that government has only a very, very indirect capacity to do anything about.
That's right.
Wouldn't you say?
Yes. I, correct, and that's what's disturbing, because in the other areas like crime and work, we had a more direct capacity.
You could, you could toughen up the laws.
Yeah. Yeah.
You could
and we had public support to do it. Whereas now, the marriage problem, society is deeply in disarray about this.
So if somebody, if a governor or a president of the United States called you in to say, I am so troubled about the weakening of our middle class.
Yeah.
And I just got reelected or elected on a platform of being a 24/7 fighter for the middle class.
Yeah.
Which, as you know,
yeah,
everybody who just got elected,
I know,
was pledging their undying devotion to the American middle class. What if they called you in for lunch and said, you know, I'm really worried about this because the middle class seems to be weakening in the ways that we're talking about.
Yeah.
The 30% are doing pretty well. The rest are not.
Yeah.
We're drifting toward a two-nation status of the people who are thriving and the others who are falling comparatively further behind. I am worried sick over this.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me, what are the two or three things that I could do?
I think the most important thing is to just make the family a priority such that people who are married or could get married will take it seriously. I think it probably solutions lie primarily at the level of public opinion. I don't know that there's a more direct solution right now.
There's no handle that public policy could come up with, or there's more. It's more of
there's another
thinking
thing
about the institutions of civil society.
Correct. I think there's one thing you could do. I think this would be constructive, and I'm not an expert on this, but it seems to me we have to make it harder to get married and harder to get divorced. Right now, people drift into relationships without marriage at all, or if they do get married, they then sometimes break up casually when they didn't really need to, and where there was reason to think that the marriage could have continued.
You know, we came up with a proposal, a very median proposal, if I would say so, where you extend the waiting period to divorce to 1 year, and you require an educational module that can be taken online that includes not only the responsibilities of post-divorce parenting, but also involves the possibility of reconciliation resources for those couples who want them. And research shows that about 15 or 20% of couples, even when a divorce has been filed for, about 15 or 20% of couples are saying they would be interested in saving the marriage. So you have you have a waiting period of 1 year, and you require some period of reflection with a modest educational component.
See, I'd make that a little stronger. I'd say that you have
Correct.
I think you should have some kind of counseling where the counselor would have to assure that the couple had worked through their issues and they were really irreconcilable. That is, that there are reasons to think that they just couldn't get along, that they had deep differences and such that the marriage couldn't continue. And we certainly don't want to forbid divorce in all cases. Obviously, there are situations where it's necessary. But it wouldn't be automatic. You'd have to show that you really made a struggle to keep going.
Well, but that would require a significant modification of no-fault divorce.
Yes, it would. And that I think.
And I'll tell you, I have been there trying to make that argument.
Yes.
And if you ask Americans the following three questions, here's the answer.
Mm-hmm.
One, do you think the divorce rate today is too high, too low, or just about right?
Yeah.
Way too high, everyone says.
Correct.
Question number two, do you think today's high divorce rate hurts children, helps them, or doesn't have much impact on children?
Yeah.
Hurts, everyone says. Question number three, is there anything under heaven that you would support to limit the unilateral right to divorce on demand?
Yeah.
No. Not even close. Not one thing.
Well,
nothing.
Okay, here's another idea. I would also make it harder to get married. That is, if you want to be married and care of that status in life, you have to prove that you have taken your relationship serious enough so it's likely to continue. When you get married in a church, for example, the clergy require that you go through premarital counseling.
Some do. Many do. Growing numbers do.
Yeah. And the point is that what the clergy want to know is that those who want to get married have worked through their issues.
Have you thought about this?
Yeah. Have you thought about issues that you might find contentious later, like money, like children, like in-laws, like health issues? Yeah. You know, those. Have you discussed these things?
And sometimes they actually advise you to either
don't go forward.
Don't go forward, or at least take a time out here while you think through it more carefully.
I think that's very constructive.
Yeah.
And now, that only occurs in church marriage, and you can go down to City Hall right now and get a marriage license and no questions asked. Well, maybe the question should be asked. Maybe in government as well, you should go before an examiner who asks you these questions, and do you give credible answers, and have you really thought these things through, so that marriage is not occurring casually.
I think that what's happened is that the general view of marriage has shifted very dramatically to a matter of private ordering. That is, that we understand marriage to be the official name given to whatever relationship the two lovers are having.
Correct.
It's not an institution in the way that you and I might want it to be, as much as it is a privatized conception.
So
the idea that, you were not meeting the standards. You haven't passed the exam.
Mm-hmm.
And people aren't thinking of it that way. Correct. They're thinking of, we're in love. Well, we want to get married. No, and the internal meaning of that is up to us. It's a private matter.
I think that's right. People are seeing it that way. Remember, I'm not saying that this would be beyond anyone's reach. I'm not saying that you're going to exclude people from marriage, but they have to go through certain preparation first.
Now, this is a good switch to the last, our last topic. We talked about marriage in the poor. We talked about marriage in the middle class.
Yeah.
Let's have the obligatory gay marriage discussion now.
Okay.
Because as you know, while many hundreds of thousands of Americans have been walking out the marriage door with hardly bothering to hit the light switch on the way out.
Yeah.
A very small number of our fellow Americans have been fighting hard.
I know.
I think in many ways heroically. to gain access to this institution.
Mm-hmm.
And the public debate has been almost entirely focused on that.
Yeah, I know.
But what do you make of the whole thing?
Well, I'm basically supportive of gay marriage, but I think gays, like straight people, should face higher standards to get married and to divorce. So they should be subject to these same higher expectations. I also think that the gay issue is, in some ways, a tribute to marriage. The fact that gays want to enter into this is a sign of respect for this institution.
Isn't it interesting to you that probably the most vocal pro-marriage voices in America today
are gays? I know. And it's also a shift from the dominant face of gay culture traditionally was almost anti-marriage. The idea was that gay men particularly were in some way outside.
Sexual outsiders, flouting of convention.
Correct.
It was
this was a bohemian culture.
An anti-bourgeois sexual culture.
Correct.
Whereas now...
Now, it's almost the opposite. They're headed towards respectability. And
we had John Corvino here recently, and we talked about this notion of the lessening of gay differentness, partly by virtue of fighting for marriage and now becoming married.
Yeah. And at my church, there are a number of gay couples who function, as far as I can see, just like straight couples.
A number of gay couples. Yeah. I happen to know, because you're down at NYU, you go to a church that's mostly gay and lesbian.
Correct. But the tone of it is still resolutely middle class. That is, the gay couples, they operate, as far as I can see, very much like the straight couples. And this affects my attitudes on
this. I thought you were supposed to be a conservative. You're supposed to worry about the social cost of change in this area. Yeah.
I think that what they're doing is basically paying homage to these traditional values. And I don't see why we should question their adherence to marriage. As I say, I think we should be cautious because we don't really know right now whether it's going to be as easy for gays to stay married as straight people. Straight people having a hard enough time.
I was going to say, it would be hard to imagine doing worse, although I guess it's possible.
It's going to be a social experiment to go through with this.
Right.
It's one that we need to have. At the same time, so I'm encouraged by this recent development. At the same time, I think you're suggesting the same, the gay issue is a bit of a red herring. It doesn't actually get to the core marriage issue, which is among straight people. It's not among gays, but among straight people that marriage is collapsing.
Right.
And that is much more serious because the straight people, of course, are much more numerous.
And the last time anybody looked, 96% of us were heterosexuals.
Yeah.
95,
correct.
Maybe. So
it's a mistake to let the gay question take up all of our attention here. It isn't really the main problem.
But you support gay marriage because you see... It's almost like you're seeing examples of what you've been calling for in your work for a kind of, you want to be in a disciplined institution?
Exactly.
You want to play by certain rules? Participate in the common institutions that denote citizenship and...
Correct. That's what's ultimately in the background here. Do we start to include marriage as falling within what I'm calling the common obligations? Now, I didn't do that in my books because there was no evidence that the public thought of this as something that was in any way a public matter. It was seen as a private matter. Whereas work and obeying the law, getting through school, these have a public aspect. They're part of citizenship. And maybe what we're edging towards, because of the struggle over marriage, we're edging towards a view that marriage should maybe be considered now as something part of one's regular identity as an American, something that we now think is part of who we should be, and as a general matter. And we do it because we want to worry about the next generation, and also because we think that's something that Americans should have as part of their experience. It's somehow necessary to other social virtues. Yeah, I mean, the core of the marriage problem and the marriage achievement, when it works, is to maintain a relationship in settings where relationships are often difficult. And in some ways, the struggles most people have in their private life is precisely to maintain relationships with various people, with their spouses, with their children, with their friends, their associates. And much of the hope that people have about life is tied up in those relationships. And if those fail, then life loses its purpose. Whereas if it succeeds, if the relationships succeed, then life is happy. And for most people...
Do you really think this could become some kind of requirement? Or
I don't know yet.
You know, this is an institution of the civil society is not the law has an influence on it, but it's not a legally... law did not create marriage. Marriage comes out of the human drive for pair bonding and the exigencies of bearing and raising children.
Correct. But it has large effects on the society that we collectively worry about.
Yeah.
We can't say this is unimportant, that it's totally a private matter, because it has such large effects on the children and eventually on the society, and the capacity to sustain civil society, including large-scale organization, depends on the capacity to build relationships. And people are not likely to be able to do that unless they have done it in their private life. So marriage is really, as the ancients told us, the basis of society. And unless you have...
In some ways, it's the seedbed institution of the civil society.
That's right.
And anything is possible. We live in such an over-the-top, interesting country with all kinds of capacity, and the free life is a pretty exhilarating and hard-to-predict life, so we might just keep on keeping on and stomping on pigs every day and everything else and make it. But it's hard to really see how this is going to work into the future.
And again, I don't think that's what freedom really means.
With
freedom
60 or 70% of the country not being able to sustain a family.
No, that isn't what freedom means. Freedom doesn't mean, in America anyway, freedom doesn't mean lack of responsibility. It means, I think, bearing a set of responsibilities that are chosen, to be sure, but then involve serious commitments.
You're the last old-fashioned Protestant, man. maybe you and me.
Well, but typically, and this is my problem with the culture, even at its most conservative, even centuries ago, didn't really face up to the core marriage problem, which is maintaining the relationship among the spouses. We honor marriage, and it's a big symbol, and there are these texts in all the holy books that various religions have about how important marriage is. But none of them face up centrally to the struggle that marriage involves. So although we should in some way promote marriage and even in some way make it an expectation, at the same time, we have to somehow honor the struggle involved. And we have to bring that out of the shadows and make it part of our everyday conversation. We have to say, this is in fact what marriage involves. We ought to honor that. Yet at the same time that we're saying that marriage should acquire a somewhat greater level of expectation.
Yes.
So at the one hand, I want to be more demanding about it. On the other hand, I also want to open the door to a more candid conversation about what marriage involves.
That would involve helping people think through
how to
be more likely to get the success you want from it.
And I think the marriage movement in some ways is more candid about the requirements than we've ever seen before.
It has been an attempt to do that, although, as you say, very... And someone who's just spilled blood over this. But the results so far have been meager. You know, it's not exactly like write home about in terms of some of the results of the studies that have looked at these programs. Mm-hmm. But I do agree with you that there's a kernel of something very important there.
See, and we do this in other areas. In the work area, in the education area, we set people serious challenges. And we also listen to their struggles, and we honor those struggles.
Yeah.
And we're sympathetic at the same time we're demanding. And I think we need to do the same about marriage. We need to be more demanding. We need to have higher standards. At the same time, we need to honor the struggle. Mm-hmm. And we have to somehow do both of those
things. And don't take... You've said this on every single issue. You don't... And I think this is what separates you from a lot of conservatives. I don't even know how you identify yourself philosophically, but... You don't have a hands-off attitude to people that are experiencing challenges, and you don't have a... You're a communitarian in that sense. You want authoritative institutions to
Correct.
Be operating.
Correct.
And if it costs a few tax dollars more to have that happen, you're more than happy to.
I mean, this sort of thing that goes on in my teaching. You know, I demand that my students write papers, and I correct their language and want them to rewrite. At the same time, I help them do it. You know, I mean, setting standards, but I'm also helping them do it.
Yeah.
And I think we need to do the same thing here. Right now, marriage suffers from having neither standards nor a candid discussion of the struggles.
Yeah.
We don't have either of those things.
Yeah.
So in some ways, the way we've dealt with the struggles is by eliminating the standards.
Yeah.
What we've done is allowed people to get married and unmarried casually because we don't want to face up to the struggles.
Yes.
See, most of the fruits of marriage come from getting through the struggles and discovering that you can actually do this.
Yeah.
And
you know, I'm sure you've seen the research. They show that because it's popular belief that the marriages that last are marriages where the couples are not fighting.
Yeah.
And the research shows that that's not true at all.
I know.
Almost all couples have a pretty high level of conflict and fighting. And the couples that last, the marriages that last are those couples that can handle it well.
Yeah.
Know what to do when these conflicts emerge.
Correct. And there's change over time.
Right.
It's not as if, in some ways, the sign of trouble is if there isn't change over time.
Right.
If you're always trapped in the same issue and you don't adjust.
Right.
But what happens in a healthy marriage, mostly, is that you move on from one thing to the next. And there's constant adjustment.
Stop studying this stuff about the poor. Just come join us in the marriage effort, you know, man.
Well, this is, I think, the leading frontier for the culture.
Yeah.
This is the place where we need to be braver than we have been.
Yes.
Facing up to these struggles.
Yes.
And in some ways, this is the return of the repressed, I guess, to use an old-fashioned phrase. You know, the thing we haven't faced, we must finally face. One reason we can do it is that other struggles we had in the past have now been either overcome or they're less pressing than they were. I mean, America in some ways is a totally dominant country with our institutions obeyed and honored around the world.
Richer than Croesus.
Yeah. We have, therefore, more opportunity maybe to focus on this private matter than we previously ever had before.
Interesting. Amen, man.
Yeah.
Let's see if anybody wants to ask a question. Yes, sir.
No.
My question is it effective to sell marriage without stigmatizing out of wedlock birth by simply emphasizing the dollars and cents sort of facts about the outcomes for the kids.
Yeah.
So getting away from
Correct.
The idea that you're condemning the other style.
I think there is some effectiveness in that appeal particularly for low-income people. For them, the central case you have to make is that marriage is teamwork towards the goals that they share. In particular, most poor parents would like to build a better life for themselves than they've known before. They would like to move to the suburbs and have a middle-class life. But given the fact that mostly they're low-skilled and they can't get very high-paying jobs, they can accomplish that only if there's teamwork, even if they work together. It means they both have to work, they have to help their kids get through school, and eventually be able to move to the suburbs and achieve what they want to do. But there has to be long-term commitment to do that. So the practical case is, I think, compelling for some people. I think that is indeed what most poor people want to achieve. And to do that, they will, in fact, have to stay married, unless they, of course, totally avoid ever having children at all. And for the middle class, the goal is a more intimate one. I think that most middle class people aspire to have something more like intimacy with a partner, to be happy in some emotional sense. That is more important for them. And for them, I think you have to say, yes, you can achieve this, but there will be struggles, and you can't imagine that it's going to happen automatically just by being married. There's research showing that many Americans think that marriage is an exercise in self-fulfillment, that when you get married, you allow yourself to be happy in ways you weren't before. That's all that's involved. Well, that's a fantasy, you know? Now, I think the fruits of marriage are enormous, but they don't come simply through having a good time in some immediate sense. Rather, they come through the realization that you can maintain a relationship. That's the good news about marriage. It's basically the fact that you may have had failures with relationships in the past, with your parents, with your siblings, with other people you've known, And a good marriage, in part, turns that around by saying it is, after all, possible to relate to other people in a constructive manner. That's the prize. That's the thing.
But you know, the gentleman's question, I mean, yeah. My own reaction to it is I'm not sure that we can be serious about anything and say that we're not going to use any kind of stigma.
Yeah.
For example, we don't like people to die of lung cancer and cost us all a lot of money and ruin their health by smoking, but we're not going to say anything bad about smoking. We're just going to point out.
Yeah, smoking's another case where we're prepared to be.
We don't like you to drive drunk, but we're not going to get too heavy-handed about it.
No.
You know, in other words, if we take a behavior seriously, and I do understand this notion of hectoring people and trying to punish them into good behavior, that never works. It's counterproductive. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. stigma, in the sense the way anthropologists use the word stigma, there is, yeah. You can't be serious about something unless you stigmatize its
correct.
Opposite. Yes, sir.
On the subject of smoking, I sort of think that the stigma is here now. But it started with lung cancer. It started that it's going to kill you, which was a very concrete
correct.
Message. And then I think slowly but surely, and now if you look at someone smoking, ugh.
Yeah, correct.
Worst ever.
I'm not sure that it was regarded as a sin and a vice.
Yeah,
until the health issue and secondary.
Until that started, yes. Big time.
I think that's true. I think that's probably true. But then you look at drinking. Drinking has been stigmatized for a long time, excessive drinking anyway, as undesirable. And indeed, we had prohibition for a while.
But we're more recently more abstemious about drinking today than we were
correct.
30 or 40 years ago.
Correct.
I remember Norman Podhoretz. Somebody asked him once, he said, what's the big difference between being a public intellectual today versus 50 years ago? He said, we drank more. We're always drinking, you know. Now everybody's drinking water.
Yeah, correct.
This is what we're doing.
Yeah, but I think it's one thing I want to comment on. The idea that enforcing a behavior involves hectoring, it usually doesn't come to that. Most people, and this is certainly what we see in areas where we've done it, welfare reform and schools, another example. It's not hectoring. It's simply making clear expectations. You don't shout and scream. And if it comes to that, then you've done something wrong. It's more subtle, and it's more indirect. You simply make clear that you expect certain things, and then people usually comply, because these are values they have themselves. See, one of the things that makes all this doable is that the values are not really in question here. It's not about values. We're not saying people don't believe in marriage. They still do. The support for marriage, the institution, is quite high. People are not questioning marriage. It's all to do
Americans with are somewhat exceptional about this too.
Yeah, they are.
Americans love the idea of marrying. Mm-hmm. They do it frequently, and that makes us different than a lot of other places. So
That's right.
Somebody else want to jump in?
Yeah.
Charles, how you doing, man?
Different question. The term sacrifice. Is there any room in the argument out there for? Sacrifice. I just think my parents, grandparents just went out of their way to always give more of themselves, be there better than their best selves to their spouse.
Yeah.
You know, sacrificing things all over and had tremendous marriages, almost viewed the same as like our consumption. You know, a lot of our financial problems that we worry and complain about, 80% of that is from overconsumption. I mean, or living above our means.
Correct.
And we almost sometimes in marriages we live above our means because we want to do other things that are for me instead of us.
Yeah.
But is sacrifice a term that's just not allowed in today's culture?
How
can that become part of it?
I mean, I've written exactly one article about marriage, and in that I actually criticized the idea that marriage is about sacrifice. Some of the rhetoric of marriage is overly sacrificial. It talks about doing everything for the kids, for example, or for the spouse. And actually, you can't get along with people on that basis. I mean, I was raised on that basis. My parents taught me to assume the burdens of every relationship and never make any expectations. Well, that's a way to be unpopular, as a matter of fact. And it doesn't work. So there has to be mutuality. You have to give and receive. And that's why it's hard to write any rules for this. It's hard to say exactly what's required to get along with somebody. You have to trust them as well. Which means that you sometimes make demands. And yes, there is sacrifice, But the key is that it be mutual, that you experience the other as also sacrificing for you. And the key is that there's commitment, and you can trust the other to be there for you, and vice versa. And that's what makes it different from the casual relationship, and that's why commitment is so important to the idea of marriage and the rewards. That's why the idea that it's all about happiness and fulfillment is selling it off cheaply, actually. That isn't what marriage is about. It's about maintaining a relationship and therefore believing, actually, that there's such a thing as love that has enduring quality. That is something that we don't assume is true in the rest of the world. So that's the pearl of great price, the thing you have to hang on to. Sacrifice is required, but again, it must be mutual, and you can't reduce it to a set of rules.
The pearl of great price is that you can love another person over time.
Yes, exactly.
You can maintain that. When Dietrich Bonhoeffer was in prison in 1944, about to be killed by the Nazis, he wrote a letter to an engaged couple and to read on their wedding day, and the letter said, "From this day forward, it won't be your love that keeps your marriage alive, it will be your marriage that keeps your love alive."
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, I think that's exactly right.
Now he had the idea that marriage was an institution that in some ways kept the flame going, gave you your best chance for keeping the internal flame going over time.
I think that's right.
Whereas I think that, I'm not sure about this, but it seems to me that if you asked Americans in their 20s and 30s and maybe 40s today to explain the meaning of that idea, that it's not your love that keeps your marriage going, but it's your marriage that keeps your love going, I think you would find a lot of tongue-tied individuals who would not know how to make sense of that thought.
Yeah, I think that's right. I once met a man who said he'd been married twice, and then he said after a pause, to the same woman. That is, they had a certain phase in their marriage which crashed and burned at some point, and he didn't go into details, but they rebuilt it on different bases.
Yeah.
And now they're still married. Is it the same as before? No. Probably lacking certain appeal that the earlier phase had, but they have something else going now.
Yeah.
And there'll probably be some further stage.
Yeah.
And that's exactly the adventure that I think you embark on when you get married. You can't assume it's going to be the same thing all the way through.
Yeah.
I think there are people for whom it doesn't change, who are just content in some basic sense and who go forward. But I don't think that's the typical example. And it's this process of change and adjustment that I think is largely outside the culture, which we really don't discuss openly.
Mm-hmm.
And we should. We ought to say, there ought to be biographies of marriages, you know, where people talk about how they built and rebuilt their relationship over time.
So you want to make, if I'm understanding you right, you want your idea, your in some ways your advice to the president in this hypothetical example, be that you can't pass a law to do this, but through the bully pulpit and through encouraging people in religion and civil society, you would want to make marriage a public issue in the sense of a public good that we all care about.
Yeah.
And we're willing to talk about it everyday plain way.
That's right.
And
it's part of who it's something that society expects you to do if you're going to have a relationship with the opposite sex at all. There are people who don't, of course. There's no requirement to be married. But if you're going to relate to the opposite sex and have this kind of relationship, or indeed,
or under the new regime, we're going to have to
correct.
Parabond.
Correct, parabonding. Okay.
Yeah.
Then. That's something that we expect you to take seriously.
Yeah.
And we're not saying that all marriages could be preserved. There will be situations where it's hard and you have to give up. One minister I had said that such a thing as you can say that you're married till death. Well, it's possible for the relationship to die before the spouses. It is possible for there to be total destruction and you have to begin again. I think that really does happen. So divorce still has to be possible. But it should be only as a last resort. It should be when you're quite convinced you cannot continue this process of mutual adjustment.
Yeah.
And we ought to be more sympathetic to this process, because that's what I think would make it easier for us to be more demanding about marriage as well, where we say, yes, this is serious and we can't be casual, we can't allow the instability we see now. Same time, we have to allow more room in the culture for this. We have to talk more about it.
Mm-hmm.
We have to be more open and candid about the struggles. And this is part of life that we need to address and learn about, even when we're not married. This would be for children as well as for, at a certain age, certainly, and for other people as well. And that's one of the things that you do when you provide support for people who are in trouble, and that everyone has friends who are in danger of breaking up. And what do you do then? Well, you listen to them, and you hear them talk about it, and you make, that's the main thing you do, and you might also offer a suggestion, but mainly you're sympathetic. You hear them describe the struggles, and that has to be taken seriously.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate this, man. I mean, it's been interesting for me, this conversation, because I hear on the basis of study and scholarship and years of experience, you have a certain way of thinking about social issues, and now you can now help all of us apply that, or at least begin the process of thinking about how you take that into it on a little bit different question, related but different. And I do agree that this is in some ways the big challenge we face. So I really appreciate it. It's been great. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you all.
My pleasure. Yeah.